My name is Ricardo Melendez Ortiz. I'm the head of the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this dialogue, which we are co-organizing today with the World Energy Council. And Dr. Christoph Frey, the Secretary General of the World Energy Council, is with us and will be co-moderating with me, and we will be sort of taking turns in different panels. And so just a few words before I give the floor to Christoph, and then he will take it from there, introducing our first panel and moving on into the substance. We have decided to focus this time around on the question of clean energy technologies through trade policy, and particularly looking at global value chains, the organization of I should say innovation, production, trade, and deployment of those technologies in a world again of value chains, and then the role of trade policy. For us, the context is very clear when it comes to this issue. We have to put at the sort of the highest concern the question of scaling up the supply and use of clean energy to enable decarbonization of the global economy as an imperative to be able to reach the stabilization of world temperature on 2 degrees Celsius, as has been agreed in the Paris Agreement last year. But obviously, there's much more to why we're interested in these issues and the linkages with trade policy. It has to do, obviously, with energy really as an enabler of economic activity and modern life to a great extent. And so what I mean by that is that we're obviously also concerned about generally issues related to energy availability and security, as well as I said before, the environmental concerns, specifically those around emissions and climate change. From the perspective of emissions, production and use of energy is responsible for 72% of global greenhouse gases. It could be a bit more than that, depending on which numbers you're using. And going forward, we know that energy demand will be increasing towards 2040 from a 2012 base by about 50%. Most of that demand will come from developing countries where there's either no access to modern forms of energy, or you continue to have a situation of what many refer to as energy poverty, so lower levels of availability of energy than what you would have in more developed regions in the world. So we're facing a double challenge of looking for decarbonization, knowing that the main sources of energy today contribute to emissions in a major way, and facing growing demand. And so for many years, we have been working here in trying to find out how trade policy and the frameworks at the multilateral level, but also at any other levels, do impinge on the efforts to rapidly scaling up the use of clean energy technologies to meet those challenges. In the context of the Paris Agreement, countries have committed to actions for mitigation. Some 165 countries have submitted their national determined contributions, as they're calling the Paris Agreement, of which about 45% contain trade policy measures or actions. But only 6% really relate to making energy either more efficient or facilitating, again, further innovation, production and deployment of clean energy technologies. We believe that there is a very big space there for countries to do more and to think about, again, the use of trade policy to facilitate that that scale up. And as we move forward from 2020 into implementation of NDCs, and we go into what has been agreed as a ratcheting up period of on commitments, again, we're expecting that trade policy will play a more important role. For the past few years, we've been talking about clean energy technologies, thinking about a number of technologies that are more commonly used, particularly wind and solar PV. But now that scope of technologies is broadening up. And as we look towards the future, we now find that new technologies such as energy storage batteries, smart grid technologies, solar panels that are also that are now embedded into surfaces like roads and buildings and constructions and so on, are going to also become more and more important from our perspective on, again, on the linkages to trade. In the WTO, there is an agreement, a plurilateral agreement called the Information Technologies Agreement. And that agreement has gone to a review. It was agreed in 1996 on a number of affecting a number of goods that were relevant in 1996. It was reviewed in 2015 in what is called now the ITA2, and it contains a very important number of technologies related to clean energy technologies. And some of the issues that we're talking about. There's also been an effort more recently, partly driven by the decision among the APEC countries to liberalize tariffs in a good number of environmental goods that contain also some of the energy technologies. In the WTO, there was an effort to, or there's been an effort to negotiate a plurilateral environmental goods agreement, which would also contain a very important number of components and goods related to energy technologies. That agreement was expected to be finalized late last year. There were some impasses related to disagreement on the coverage of the agreement. And so the agreement is still on a standby, and we're hoping that the agreement will be reactivated, the negotiations will be reactivated, and the agreement will be concluded as soon as possible. The agreement deals with tariffs at the border, and everybody that has looked into these issues in the past few years knows that that will be important but insufficient, again, in a context of global value chains, where non-tariff measures, as well as the services that are embedded or related to the deployment of technologies in this field, are absolutely critical to really have an effective liberalization of these technologies. The ITA, on its part, will probably face now a situation where we're seeing a blurring in the fields, in technology fields, between information technologies, transportation, and clean energy. And so it will soon probably find that it will need to be expanded as well, at least from that perspective of clean energy, to really cover the kind of goods that we're concerned with now. So for all these reasons, we think that it is important to discuss, continue to discuss these matters at the WTO. We are quite aware of the political context in which we are and the challenges that we're facing. We're aware of the complexity of the policy landscape when it comes to energy. But we believe that a constructive and forward-looking discussions among trade policy makers, particularly, on what it's going to be, certainly an expanding trade and energy interface as we move forward, is critical. And that's why we have convened this panel at this time. The World Energy Council has been working on what they call, well, the scenarios for the future and what they call the trilemma, the basic trilemma or fundamental trilemma that we're facing in our energy outlook. And so I'll turn to Christoph Frey to talk to us about that. Just one more word on the day ahead. You have biographies of speakers as well as the agenda with you. We would not necessarily introduce each of the speakers. We have a fantastic roster of panelists that are going to be with us today. And what we have strived to do is combine policymakers from the fields of trade and energy with experts as well as private sector perspectives. And we're very privileged to have with us some key representatives from the private sector in that regard. And so I'll turn to Christoph now for some words, and then I'll let you go on with the first panel. Christoph, if you may.
Thank you, Ricardo. And just to introduce, I think we are very proud to have this partnership with ICTST when it comes to trade dialogue in the context of WTO activities. We are. So let me try again. Now it seems to be better. We are at WEC spending more time than ever talking about trade. And I want to just as introduction give you a sense why this is the case, and then obviously introduce the panel and go into this first panel. Let me also take the opportunity just to briefly introduce Tim Richards here. He is the chair of WEC's trade work. So anything I cannot answer because I'm not a specific trade expert, Tim will be in a very a good position to actually then answer on behalf of WEC. But to introduce, I think the key, why are we spending more time on trade issues today than ever before, is I would like to summarize it as follows. First of all, we are in what we call the grand energy transition. And this transition, the World Energy Council, we are in 100 countries. We have 3,000 organizations, public, private, expert organizations in those 100 countries as our members. And 3 years ago, we were still asking the question, are we at the tipping point? Is this, you know, is this really, are we coming over this tipping point? We are well known for our World Energy Congresses, and at the last Congress that took place in October last year, we said the tipping point is clearly, we are over the tipping point now. And I'm just going to introduce a few of the points why we believe we are over the tipping point, but then what are the implications? What are the implications if we take issues, be that the Sustainable Development Goals, be that the COP objectives as important? Why is trade such a critical unlocker of to achieve those objectives? So first, transition. The keywords about the transition, there's three fundamental drivers for the energy transitions that we see. And the first one is obviously decarbonization. It's obvious that the fact that we have today 2.8 times more equivalent CO2 emissions in proven reserves than we are allowed to emit is the first big issue. The fact that we had today 2,800 gigatons of proven equivalent CO2 emissions in proven reserves in coal, oil, gas, and we are only allowed to emit 1,000 if we look at the carbon budget that we have available to not exceed 2 degrees Celsius heating is a first big driving issue. And you have mentioned COP, and if you ask quickly the question, you know, what does it mean when we take this COP? How much have the NDCs really achieved? We believe the NDCs has taken us roughly a third of the way that it would actually take to get to the full objective. So we're roughly on a third of the way. We also are saying that over the past 45 years, we have decarbonized GDP with 1% per year. And if we want to achieve objectives, we have to go to 6% per year. This is not slow acceleration. This is not evolution. It's rather revolution. And that gives the first very important benchmark what we are talking about in this transition. The second driving force, if the first is decarbonization, is the reality of new business models, fundamental new business models that challenge existing capital, that challenge existing structures, that challenge basically a lot of the things that are out there. And there's many instances, there's a lot of good news when it comes to rural electrification. There's obviously lots of discussion and challenge in the e-mobility side. We are talking about energy blockchain. We are talking about so many things that fundamentally give us a new perspective in energy, and obviously that is a massive big driving force in itself, just the availability of those new business models as a second fundamental driving force. The third driving force is new risks. The new risks, is it cyber, extreme weather, or energy, water, food nexus? Those are three risk areas. But you take all those three driving forces together and you ask, so what does it mean? And do we get in the direction of a world that fulfills the climate objectives and that delivers secure energy and that makes this at affordable prices? Then clearly we see with our scenarios today, we are slower than what it takes to get there in time. And I think the question then has to become, if with current rates of innovation on the policy, business model and technology side, we are not fully on target, what does it take to unleash those learning curves? And I think the easiest way to put this is to say, well, what is trade if not putting volume behind technology? And what is a learning curve? A learning curve in a technology area is simply the fact that by increasing volume, you accelerate the innovation, you push the progress. Now, I'm just going to give you one scenario that we have published a number of scenarios, and I'm just going to give you a brief sense of the scenarios and then open the panel. But it's very important to understand what happens if we don't do that. In a world where we do not encourage that trade, where we do not encourage also things like carbon agreement, where we kind of are more inward-looking, more fragmented, what happens? We choose more, yes, renewable energy because it's local. That's a good thing, isn't it? But we choose more energy based on less good technology, on more expensive and less effective technology. That will lead us to less good outcomes. We are choosing probably nuclear as well, because nuclear has always been an inward-looking also choice to increase security. But that nuclear is less safe because it is less reliant on effective international safety institutions, and it can less depend on best technology that comes from strong trade and best technologies being ruled out. We are looking at more coal because countries focus more on coal with less effective, efficient technologies, and therefore CO2 emissions go up. So the very short story, and we have published those scenarios, they are all out there if you want the numbers, but the short story, we need to empower trade to go and those things which eventually lead us in a less secure, more dirty and more expensive energy world, which goes against all the prosperity issues that we have at heart. And I think that's the reason why we are so much invested today in the trade discussion, more so than perhaps even before. And that's the reason why I'm extremely pleased to open this panel, very rich panel with diverse perspective from government, from expert and private sector. And I want to, with no further delay, just go into the first contribution from Jonathan Freed. He is the ambassador of Canada to WTO and will bring us a perspective from Canada. Please, Jonathan.
Well, Dr. Frey, thank you, and thanks to ICTSD and the World Energy Council for coming together to trigger this thought and reflection this morning. I'm almost tempted to say let's adjourn and have a discussion, because Ricardo and your overviews, I think, were very comprehensive and very thought-provoking. But you've asked me to add a few remarks, and I will. I'm not here to speak on behalf of all governments. I'm a government representative, and I suppose Canada is in a fairly unique position to offer some thoughts. On the one hand, we're very proud to be a remarkably global leader in the generation of clean and renewable energy. We're the world's second largest producer of hydroelectricity. 80% of the electricity we generate in Canada produces no greenhouse gas emissions. On the other hand, as many of you will know, we're host to the third largest proven oil reserves and associated gas and shale reserves in the world, most of it untapped. And we're determined to manage those resources in an environmentally sensible way. So we tend to have a balanced view. We know and are committed to heading towards a low-carbon economy, but we recognize the economic realities that the transition will require the consumption and use of fossil fuels during that transition, and as was implied, we need to do so consistent with Paris in a way that contributes to the reduction of emissions. We also need to take a global view and put things in relative context. Just to take a simple example, if Canada produces more natural gas and it is consumed in the United States, that's actually a good thing because it's replacing higher emission coal. Canada, on most calculus, is penalized for that. We actually should be credited for reducing U.S. Emissions. So, against that backdrop, we are talking about this motivated by Paris, motivated by our goals for 2030, and motivated, as was said in the introduction, by pursuing nationally determined contributions, NDCs, and making those reality. Canada has set out a very comprehensive national plan. There are four pillars. We are going to be and have in many of our provinces already pricing carbon pollution, so we've opted for, in effect, a carbon tax as opposed to cap and trade. We are proactively looking at the policies that will best help to reduce emissions throughout the economy. We're committed to climate adaptation and mitigation and right through to reduction, we're investing heavily in innovation, including in carbon capture and storage. And for a country of 35 million people, we've allocated and committed $1 billion already to support that innovation. All of which is to say, as the NDCs imply, each and every country pursuing implementation of Paris is focused on national plans to do so. So when we talk about how trade can contribute, we need to keep in mind that trade is an adjunct, is a supporting part of national plans. If you just try and do trade policy to meet your targets and not pay attention to what is central, which is what are your national policies, you're not going to get very far. So the real question is, what kind of trade rules, which trade topics do we need to look at when keeping in mind the central focus of most governments, which is their national plans? So in the 10 minutes I have, I'm going to give you 10 different aspects of trade policy, a minute each, that I think those of you representing missions and are reporting back to capitals may wish to think about, and we here in Geneva need to integrate into our ongoing discussions. First, and of course most traditionally, is what's the role of trade in goods and the tariff. You're well familiar with the attempt among like-minded countries to agree on an environmental goods agreement, to go to zero tariff on environmentally friendly goods. We came close before the end of the year, but did not succeed in 2016. I can certainly say that from all the participant countries with whom I have talked since then, there remains a broad appetite to continue those discussions, to re-engage and to explore whether we can bring that initiative to at least a plurilateral conclusion. That's not to say, boy, great, if we succeed, we're done. First of all, the participants in the EGA would love to see it become multilateral and universal, so it's meant to be a living agreement by way of expanding its participation and membership. And secondly, it's meant to provide a foundation for going beyond the tariff to look both at non-tariff barriers to trade in goods and possibly look at liberalization of environmentally related trade and services. I'll come back to that. Number two, government procurement. We have under WTO auspices a plurilateral agreement with limited participation but representing a significant part of the global economy. And let's face it, the kinds of infrastructure investments and innovation we're looking at, a lot of it will be led by government in the first instance. Do we have sufficiently broad coverage to ensure that the rules governing government procurement promote open participation and competitive bidding in a way that brings the best technology to bear at the least cost? Third, again, having mentioned it in connection with the EGA, you come to the non-tariff measures represented in the WTO context by the Technical Barriers to Trade Agreement and the non-tariff measures that may themselves be an inhibition to taking advantage of low-cost, high-quality goods that can cross borders. This includes a range of issues, including whether it's appropriate or not to take account of process and production methods in looking at how you regulate goods. Is a like product unlike another product because of the way it's manufactured, because of its carbon footprint or not? There's debate among the lawyers as to whether the existing rules allow that kind of differentiation. And there's debate among policymakers as to whether it's appropriate to have that kind of differentiation. The role of standards generated by government as well as by industry. It's pretty clear that the existing rules are limited to covering government measures only. As we see more and more certification regimes, energy efficiency standards, the right good housekeeping seal of approval label generated by particular industry or consumer associations, does that actually promote or confuse the situation? So you have the TBT standards area, number three. Number four, services. Environmental services are pretty clear. I provide clean water filtration services, for example. That's an environmental service. Can we reach better agreement to cover more of such sectors? But beyond that, we need to look at how such services are delivered. And alongside technology comes the movement of people. There is a premium on the professionals and the experts and the vocations that help deliver those kinds of services. Are we prepared in this volatile environment about immigration to look at the temporary movement and facilitating the providers of services to come into a country to promote environmental services? Fifth, and this is both a WTO issue but also engages other international organizations, is the role of intellectual property and the transfer of technology. The know-how that is either embedded in a good or a service, or simply sharing and licensing the technology so it can be used locally in other countries. The TRIPS agreement does have a specific article, 66.2, that tries to promote this. In a WIPO context, the World Intellectual Property Organization context, we've not yet had a discussion dedicated to looking at patent and trademark and copyright and trade secrets through an environmental lens. That's certainly an open opportunity for those of us engaged across the street or down the street to do so. Sixth is only limited in its relationship to the WTO, and that's investment. Many of us, many countries, seek not to protect their domestic industry, but rather to attract the kinds of investments from the firms and the entities that know what they're doing in contributing to a cleaner environment. But what are the tools we should and can be using to attract and retain those investments? And then you're into the world of trade-related investment measures. Do we tie the arrival and the presence of a foreign investor to some local content requirement, local performance requirement, and so on, so as to foster the development of domestic industry? That's pretty well prohibited. Do we offer special subsidies and incentives to make it attractive to come to my country rather than yours? Then you're into looking at whether the existing rules on subsidization have some role. And if it's not covered in a WTO context, then we need to look at that web of over 3,000 bilateral and regional investment treaties to see the manner in which they do or do not promote or inhibit environmentally friendly investment. Seventh, e-commerce, as it's called in a WTO context, or as Ricardo suggested, the broader universe of digitally related business. There are elements spread throughout existing WTO agreements, including a moratorium on customs duties on goods delivered through electronic means, telecommunications services as an annex to the GATS, and so on, but there are swaths of digital-related commerce that are not quite covered. There is an ongoing work program at the WTO that's been there since 1998. Some debate as to whether it's on the agenda for discussion only or for negotiation. And certainly the topic has gained increased focus and increased dynamism over the last couple of years. This year, in parallel, Germany, as the chair of the G20, is hosting a work program leading up to a ministerial meeting on digital commerce and the economy. How can we best promote the kinds of technologies and the flow of data that would support smart grids, for example, or simply the assurance that data can flow between countries to the extent that farmers have access to information about climate, about water supply, and so on. They will be more efficient users of resources and therefore should be generating lower emissions, less water consumption, and so on, which again will be a major contributor to the environment. Eighth, it's a bit of a basket, but I would say there's a universe of aspects of existing WTO rules where we owe it to ourselves to ask, do they need clarification or updating? First of all, in relation to subsidies, are there such things as good rather than bad subsidies? Subsidies, supposedly, if they're dedicated to a particular industry in a manner that displaces or undermines the ability of another industry to compete, are bad. But what if it's for a good purpose? Does the end justify the means? Do we need to look at an exemption or a more specific definition of subsidies that takes account of environmental purposes? And in defining what's the industry and what's the relevant market, there are important questions emerging. Put aside the one aspect of the Canadian or government of Ontario feed-in tariff case, where local content was found to violate WTO rules, but the panel and the appellate body had a fascinating discussion of how do you define the relevant electricity market. Is the electricity market for renewably generated or environmentally friendly electricity different than that generated traditionally through the major generators and suppliers? Do we have enough clarity in the rules to define or to differentiate energy markets based on environmental considerations? Similarly, different line of cases, two of which involve China in a prominent way, take you to what's the role of critical materials and natural resources that we need to promote environment in a WTO context? The rare earths case, for example, what if you need that lithium? What if it's in short supply? Do we have to take account of the environmental imperatives of conserving those rare materials? Or does the WTO say, sorry, it's all open to trade all the time, no restrictions? So what's the role of the criticality of natural resources in an environmental setting? Third, under this basket, although it's being debated in a very different context right now, but certainly has lots of literature in an environmental context, is border tax adjustments for carbon pricing. If my firm is generating a good and has to pay an extra 10, 20, 30, depending dollars on its carbon footprint, and the import is paying nothing, isn't it logical to have some adjustment to put those goods on an equal footing? Then you're back to process and production methods as an issue inherent in that. And finally, under this basket, and believe it or not, it's already over 20 years that NAFTA showed the way, can we better define the relationship between WTO rules and multilateral environmental agreement rules? What the three NAFTA countries did in 1992 was to say, here are some key environmental agreements that we're all party to, and we agree in advance that if there were any conflict whatsoever between the trade rules and the environmental rules should govern and shall not be considered a violation of trade agreements. Shouldn't we be going through that exercise multilaterally? Finally, sort of WTO, but WTO plus, is the importance of examining and learning the lessons from our experience in regional plurilateral trade agreements. We have some good examples, I think, both implemented and not in recent times. The Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, dormant, I guess, is the best word to use at the moment, has a very interesting set of provisions on environmental goods. So too does the Canada-Europe Trade Agreement, which we hope and expect will be approved by the European Parliament next week, or February 15th it's scheduled for. And APEC, which is not a body that creates binding rules, early on set the tone by setting out ambition for liberalizing environmental goods and continues to have a good discussion. This should be something we can discuss and promote in the WTO Regional Trade Agreements Committee to draw out best practices and to look at what can be multilateralized. So there's my list of nine in 10 minutes, enough to keep all of us busy for a while to come. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ambassador Fried, for this very for this great overview on the list, and I'm particularly focused on the NTMs. I think you mentioned in the beginning, obviously, that the environmental good agreement is key, is not totally off the table. It's obviously had a hit last December, but zero tax on environmental goods is still a priority for, I think, probably most of us in the room here. But then you have pointed out that the tax measures are only part of the equation. You have reminded us that the non-tax measures are, there's many of those standards, the IPR, the local content, there's many of those measures. And by the way, with the report that we have recently produced, we estimate that the impact of the NTMs is double as big as the tax measures. And I'm sure Tim is going to highlight that in the following session in greater depth. I think what makes Canada such an interesting case, and probably we can save that for the discussion afterwards, but with your province, you have a lot of empowerment, obviously, when it comes to policy, energy policy in particular, to your province level. And you have truly as diverse a province landscape as the world has a country landscape. You have obviously provinces with that are truly producing provinces in the fossil sense. You have provinces that are environmental, with Quebec, the hydro, the environmental superpower. You have provinces that are innovation powers. You have provinces that still have energy access issues, BC. And I think it will be interesting, perhaps, to understand when you came up with your nationally determined contributions, you must have seen very similar type of discussions that you had to see convert in Canada as perhaps the World Committee has to go on globally. And I think just the learning on what are some of the process that have allowed you to convert, and that would certainly be part an interesting part of discussion as well. I want to move on to Surab Sen, CEO of Central Energy, and Central Energy in that sense is very special. I think you are producing solar cells, you're producing it in India and Oman, please correct if I got that wrong, but you're producing in developing or emerging context technology, but for the emerging world, and that is to that extent perhaps a less usually heard perspective. And I think that the key question is always around, and you have pointed out the local content on the one hand, the policy stability is on the other. We are very keen to hear your perspective on those issues.
Thank you, Christoph. Thank you, Ricardo.
It's an honor to be here this morning. I always like coming to Geneva to speak in ICTSD events because they are very passionate and they are very high impact. You know, I sit on a very different side of the fence in the private sector, and what I do for a living is I bring power to the people in emerging markets, in frontier markets, and in island nations. So, you know, I have a different maybe perspective than a few of my honored panelists about where the industry is going and what we see as a private sector player on a day-to-day basis. So what we do is we build large-scale solar plants in emerging markets, frontier markets, and island nations. Now, if you look at where is the big picture? What is the big picture today of the solar industry? The truth is, the big picture today of the solar industry is dark and gloomy. It's not sunny, you know? In the last 30 months, what we have seen is about $30 billion in bankruptcies, which has, I think, you know, terrified the smartest and the most cavalier investors in my hometown of Manhattan, you know, which we say is the, you know, the pot of capitalism and financing and so on and so forth. Why is that? I think with all the great intent in the world, there still remains a big divide of the have and the have-nots. And I, for one, believe that the propagation of renewable energy and clean energy technologies will happen in emerging markets and frontier markets because that's where the need is. I don't know how much is going to happen in my home country of the United States, you know, for adoption of new renewable energy plans. But I can tell you from my trips to different parts of the world in emerging markets, there's a huge amount of demand, and as Ricardo rightly pointed out, that power is a cornerstone of civilization. And what I realize when I leave Manhattan is it's great that I live in the United States, but once I go to parts of India or Africa, you know, there is no power. And, you know, this has ramification not only for trade and goods and services, it also has ramification on literacy, how children are being raised and how children are studying, you know, with kerosene lamps in different villages around the world. So I think that the force that's going to change the landscape is demand, the demand for power. What are the impediments today in making that happen? You know, I think in my mind, the first impediment is capital, you know. Anybody who invests in a project, they want a return on investment. They want an IRR that's sufficient to meet that quantum. Unfortunately, what we have seen is in the last 2 years or 3 years, even the last 12 months, there has been a high amount of bidding, competitive bidding, and it's always the race to the bottom as far as where pricing goes. But often what the domain country forgets. I often hear when I go visit a leader of a country, they say, well, you know, the last auction in the U.S. was at 5 cents, or last auction in India was at 6 cents, or last auction in the UAE was at 3 cents. That's great, but that's not you. You know, you have to understand what your country and risk profile is, and you have to come up with a tariff that substantiates and that can justify people investing capital behind it. Second of all, I think that policy is very important. You know, policy is a bedrock, and if you don't have a strong bedrock supporting the renewable and the clean energy technology industry, I think we are heading for disaster. And that's another thing. You know, when you look at the cost of doing business in a country, the first thing we, you know, go into frontier and emerging markets, and the first thing we have to do is spend a year or two in educating the leadership, the bureaucrats, the trade people, because look, renewables is a very unique business. You know, it's not big oil. It's when I got into this business, it was a cottage industry led by small people, small players, IPPs, and now we are seeing big players coming in and dominating that market simply because they have larger, stronger balance sheets, and they are driving prices down. We are seeing the distributors and the transmission people, the D&T people, or T&D people, whichever way you look at it, transmission distribution guys, getting into this business more and more and more. Why? Because of cost of capital. We have to make sure that we go out there and we educate the populace about what is available, what can they do for your country, and what is it going to cost you to build a sustainable platform that really generates power for 25 years. Now, when I got in this business of renewables a decade ago, or maybe a bit longer than that, I got in this business because it was steady cash flows for 25 years. You build a solar plant and it lasted you 25 years. That is no longer the case. I can give you many examples of solar plants coming up today in emerging markets that you're lucky if it lasts and produces power at optimal levels more than 10 years. So at the end of the day, when you're racing for the price to go to the bottom, you're also sacrificing quality. You're sacrificing the quality of goods and service and installations. So first of all, like I said, going back, is we got to look at what is the cost of capital and what are the tariffs. Second of all is skilled labor. Let's not forget, we are talking about a high technology industry. This is not a, you know, car shop that you're looking for local mechanics. This is a high-tech industry. And oftentimes what we find difficulty is when I'm talking to somebody in the U.S. or Europe and I say, hey, you have a project in West Africa or an emerging market, the first question is, sure, are you kidding me? Do you think I'm going to move with my family to that part of the world? Do you know there is this disease, there is that disease, there is this going on, there is violence? So getting skilled labor to build this plant, because you just can't say, I'm going to build a plant of global magnitude and global quality. That's all great, but who's going to build it? You know, to find the people to go out and build these plants are extremely difficult. And I think so that there needs to be, you know, an accord where there is free movement of skilled labor across borders in whichever country that we're implementing these solar plants in. The other problem that we find is, you know, excise and custom duties. You know, that's a problem, and I think that we need to work towards abolishing, you know, those tariffs and excise duties for clean energy technologies. Let's not forget, we have over 1 billion people today in this world that are not electrified. And we got to focus on how do we bring power to the people? What is the easiest and the most efficient way to build a sustainable plant that we can be proud of, all of us. Local content. That's absolutely a deal killer for me, because at the end of the day, you know, for a company like us, we want to have the access to the global supply chain and go for the best goods and services that we can put on the ground to the country that we are helping build infrastructure in. Local content just works totally diametrically opposite to that, and it kind of binds our hands as developers as to what, you know, content we can put, and the quality is compromised. Why is the quality compromised? LCR and price. Those are the two reasons why quality is compromised. I think, you know, we are talking about battery technologies, we're talking about smart grids. In reality, you know, when you go see what I call a client country, they want all of it. They want the storage technologies, they want the smart grids, they want the highest efficiency panels, but they want to pay that 4 cents a kilowatt hour number. And I think that's a deal breaker. So we have to make sure that we understand that in life, you get what you pay for, you know, and there is no free lunch.
Thank you very much. I think those were very clear words, particularly when it comes to the local content being a deal killer. You have said, you have reminded us that policy risk must put a lens on the best deals that we see out there when it comes to solar. So the political risk of the tariff that needs to be compatible with that political risk in order to just. Please shout if I forget to do that and you can't hear me. So you need to do that on the policy side as much as on the skill side. So I think those, you haven't mentioned at all the tariffs or the tariff side or other. So I really take it that you single out local content as your biggest issue, which seems to be a very strong message. It is, that's a lot. Sorry, I missed out on that. Forgive me. But I think what you said at the very end, obviously you're focusing on frontier and emerging markets, the 1.1 billion. And I know you're active in Kenya. You told me before you are active in Kenya, and I wonder whether it's just worthwhile describing why Kenya works. I mean, do you want to spend, you know, and I think you told me Kenya is an interesting place. Do you want to quickly spend just 2 minutes, you know, saying why, what do you see in Kenya that makes Kenya work? Just as a...
Sure. I think that Kenya is very progressive in the way they are going about the implementation. And, you know, you really want a willing participant in the government who is open to installations of green energy. And they have really embraced decentralization of renewable energy in Kenya. And what we are seeing is not only in the public sector, in the private sector, there's a huge amount of impetus and excitement about commercial and industrial installations. So a lot of new buildings coming up, a lot of new warehouses coming up, where they're installing from the very get-go, you know, the solar panels on the top or wind. So they are adopters. They are embracing change. They know there is a need for power. And it's not only Kenya. I think that, you know, we are seeing East Africa, but now West Africa is waking up. You know, we are doing some very good work in Burkina Faso and Senegal and Guinea and Ivory Coast. And I think that, look, the truth is that today the sanctity of a PPA is no more. Because if Spain, Italy, Brazil, and India has made a U-turn on your PPA, then what is the sanctity of the paper that you hold? Zip, zero. So how do you build? And what our philosophy is, what we tell the governments is, let us come build you a sovereign energy asset, you know, 50 megawatts in six places. You pick where you want to, you know, where you want to power your country. And let us build that crown jewel, you know, first world, first class energy asset, and transfer that to you as a sovereign energy asset. And that is a good thing because, first of all, it limits your risk, but it also generates employment. You know, these people, these countries are hungry for employment, and you're generating a high technology job when you're building a solar plant, not only in the construction phase, but also in the maintenance phase. So I think that that's what we are seeing to be a great movement in our work.
Thank you very much. I'd like to move on to Raghunath Mahapatra, who is with us on video, and he represents a yet very different perspective. He's in India, and he deploys actually solar energy in India. And obviously, I assumed your perspective must be very complementary to somebody who delivers the technology internationally, to somebody who actually wants the best technology and deploy it locally. So very keen to hear your perspective.
Okay. Good morning to everyone. It's quite an honor to be presenting to you on the trade aspects of the renewable energy specifically, and in the context of the global trade, which is, as we are seeing, it's quite not as what it used to be. That's what I put it. I'll be just be focusing primarily on India and the solar photovoltaic industry, although I can talk on wind and other aspects that we have been busy in. But there are other people who can talk better on that. India, primarily coming from COP21 and the INDCs that we have presented. However, India, much before this COP21 and INDCs came in, we have been focusing on wind primarily. And even today, our current capacity is 50 gigawatt, which is roughly 18% of the total installed capacity in the country, which is predominantly wind. But solar PV is the current focus. Now, when I said 18% of the total installed capacity, it is in terms of installed capacity. But given the intermittency of renewable energy, around 8% of the energy comes from renewable energy as of today. I'm not including nuclear or gas-fired power plants and renewable as of now. And I'm keeping large hydros because of their inherent environmental nature. And in India, small hydros are not that big. However, for the COP21 and the INDCs and our own requirement, there is another requirement in India other than wind environment, although it's not get talked about because of our huge size. The fact remains that around 300 million people in India do not still have electricity. There's a large population, and because the grid does not reach them. And when I say they don't have electricity, these 300 million people either don't have access to electricity at all, or they get electricity for around, say, 2 to 3 hours a day, which at the best, it can be called cosmetic. So we have a target of around 100 gigawatts of solar photovoltaic by 2022. That means around 10 to 15 gigawatt per annum. Now, from the trade, I've focused on trade aspects without going into social aspects. Saurabh put it very nicely what the requirements are. I'm not going to get into that unless questioned on the same thing in context of India or South Asia, where we have explored. Now, most of the trade things comes from our module. The module constitutes around 50 to 60% of the project cost. Occasionally, people have been buying steel and DC cable, but that's very sporadic. It is not that. Now, when we come to the trade aspects of the module, it has been subject to multiple aspects. We will come to that later. But few statistics that India needs around 10 to 15 gigawatt installed capacity per annum. And we have, as per our government statistics, as of June 2016, we had cell manufacturers, only 16 cell manufacturers with an installed capacity of 1.5 gigawatt, and that to 1.1 gigawatt is operational. Whereas in module, there are 94 manufacturers with 5.85 gigawatt manufacturing, and operational is hardly 4.3. What it means is that there are too many granular producing entities And the minimum, I have just done something, minimum is 3 megawatt and the median is 32. And what happens is now, since the government is focused on 10 to 15 gigawatt per annum, the average project size has increased to 50 megawatt. That means when the bid comes out, the minimum size that you can bid for is around 50 megawatt. Occasionally, flexible bidding comes out where you can bid for 10 megawatt, 12 megawatt, 15, 20, but mostly it is 50 now. When you compare the 50 megawatt of average project size and a median manufacturing size of 32 megawatt, you know that your domestic content is not sufficient because one manufacturer cannot fulfill the need of one project. On an annual run size of 32 megawatt, if you take 50 megawatt, that means I'm number one, my installation time is hardly 4 to 5 months. To reduce my capital cost of capital and IDC, I would like to buy the module towards, because it's around 60% of my project cost. So I will keep that expense towards the end of my project. So in 4 months, the annual run of 32 megawatt, 4 months, they are not able to fulfill my need. I go to multiple vendors. So my cost of procurement goes up. And so now the next is, so the moment this comes out, as a developer, whether I like, whatever I think, I must import. Number one, there is no capacity at the high level. Number two, the run capacity is not enough for me to do that. And it has never been the focus. So now when we go for domestic content requirement in India, which is basically has been subject to various trade disputes and internally and externally, in 2013 and 14, the government started an anti-dumping duty investigation based on the complaints by the solar module manufacturers to protect themselves. And similarly, in 2016, India was dragged to WTO, and dispute settlement panel report says that it cannot have local content requirements because that violates WTO guidelines that India is signatory to. But still, what we are seeing in real life is some amount of domestic content requirement, what is LCR, DCR we call it here, so DCR continues. But very infrequent, last 6 months we haven't seen any DCR bids coming in. So because India has filed a review petition in WTO, and what we are hearing it is continuing, but and at our end as a developer, we are more or less free to buy the module, import the module from anywhere we want. Plus, this is one interesting thing, that we are still importing the wafers and cells. India does not manufacture any wafers. So most of the prices that I get quoted, even if I want a domestic content requirement fulfilled project, I get quoted in dollars. Then the other aspect that impacts me is the domestic modules are around 10 to 15% costlier than the imported modules. Now, keeping all the things put together, the main focus, the government of India has started a Make in India program where it encourages domestic manufacturing of modules and cells also, but the main focus we are seeing is on modules. Import of wafers and cells are likely to continue. Now, in this, till now, whether anything that gets used in a solar or renewable energy wind solar production plant that been generating IPP basis, if I'm setting up a generating plant, I don't pay any tax. I pay the concessionary customs duty is concessional. I pay around 4 to 5%, but not on modules. Other things I have to get on a concessional basis, subject to a declaration at the end of my project that I have used those items in my solar project, because they can be used anywhere else. And there is an inspection if required, but not regular. We developed around 1 gigawatt, that is 1100 megawatts of solar plant. There has been no inspection for us. However, there are always regularly some or other confusion comes up. One is that differing interpretation of the HS code. Recently, we faced a situation where the customs authorities, they blocked one shipment of, not ours, but somebody else, another developers, saying that, listen, the module and cell are free from any kind of duty. However, the module that you are, the panel that you are buying, the panel has an attachment to it which can transmit energy, and hence it will be taxable. Now, we went through kind of a lot of representations and things like that, because this was a kind of stretching things too far. I mean, if we don't have a mechanism to take out my energy and send it to the grid, then my panel becomes useless for me. So now, and it is not universal. It is very discretionary, and it happened at one port. So before it can spread to other customs officers who can use their discretion to have this arbitrary classification and then interpretations of this definitions, we have stopped it. However, the point that I'm making is, even the tax laws are not, the HS codes especially, they are not yet adapted to the current kind of goods. So to that extent, possibly there is a requirement to look at all the codes and classifications to classify some of them, or most of them, or these goods as green goods and or sustainable goods, or any other term that can suit, so that the delay in the project, the 2 months delay on a 4 month execution plan, is quite high, 50% delay. The next that is coming up in India is a GST introduction. The exact implications are not yet known, because the tax rules are not yet out. The council, GST council, is still debating the different kinds of taxation. There are slabs, there is no uniform rates, and there are demands for exemption. And so, however, what we are finding is that the basic customs duty is going to be out of the GST regime. And that we don't pay, but then that is subject to modification. Once it is within GST, whatever we get, we know. But if something is outside, then that's one confusion. And we ran an estimation through an external consultant to estimate how much our CapEx will increase. That we found it will increase between 6 to 10%, depending on which category items are clubbed into what and what kind of tariff will be put onto that. And the discussions on this are yet to be completed. So the main idea behind what I'm saying is that while the government is very proactive in India to not tax any of the things, or at least marginal taxation, if at all, on the goods that are being imported or used, being a democracy, we are subject to push and pull from various sides. While it is going on, as an organization, we have been able to represent our case and have been able to get good benefits. When the anti-dumping duty was being imposed, we pulled out the different benefits of where it is benefiting the economy, and we were able to convince the government that an anti-dumping duty on solar modules is not in the national economic interest. And it was taken, and there was no anti-dumping duty. Now, the point is, what there are three things. Like any emerging market, the government, because of the decline in exports, and the general economic downturn in the world, there is pressure on job creation. I mean, the demographics are changing, so there is a demand for people to get jobs. So the government is going to focus on Make in India program for two reasons. One is the local job creation, and the second is balance of payment, because a lot of things getting imported with the huge amount of focus on growth of renewable energy, there is a fear that while other imports are reducing, like oil, that may get compensated and might adversely affect our balance of payment situation. That's a point that they're still concerned. Further, any electronic and automation component using communication, especially SCADA and telecom equipments, which are being used, not necessarily for the solar sector, but a lot of that gets used, like SCADA and the GSM-based data transmission for billing purposes. They are being imported from different countries where there are serious considerations of espionage, cybersecurity, hacking, and there are, so somehow they believe that while the security, that means essentially what they're saying is that, okay, we don't have enough thing to make secure while we import. So if we restrict this and start manufacturing in India, then it will have a better one. Whether it is right, wrong, that's debatable, but that's one of those concerns. Also, they are mostly justifying a lot of things based on saying that, look, so many countries are going for protectionism, so we need, we are an emerging economy, or we don't have capital mobility, so capital convertibility is not there in capital account. So we are saying that we are not as robust, so we must be doing protectionism. It's just a general justification. At the same time, India has taken the lead during COP21 along with France to form an international solar alliance. What the International Solar Alliance is supposed to be doing is a conglomeration of around 127 countries, approximately, between the tropics of Cancer and tropics of Capricorn, where the sunshine is very high, to form kind of a block where the funds and the goods, everything can be done. It's in a nascent stage. It's like a baby now. It is still growing, and it's going. But if it works, possibly there will be enormous amount of trade opportunities. It might facilitate some amount of trade, and also it might be better to negotiate. At the same time, as Saurav was saying, that the focus on affordable electricity, that is the reducing tariff, I mean, it's like a death spiral. So it goes from down and down, and that focuses on reduced capex, and import is likely to continue. There is no way they can say that you stop importing, use DCR, and still reduce the tariff. When you are bidding, that flexibility is there. If the DCR is there, the tariff is going high. There is no question about that. And they're not very happy about it. So as of now, there is not much, but there is always pressure which is going through different things. However, what we believe that we have given a recommendation that if you are so intense or focused on the manufacturing domestic content, then invite the international manufacturers to set up and incentivize them. In that case, we will not need these trade barriers through DCR requirement, other things. Everything will become DCR, the price will come down, and the same thing will happen. And now they are going to duty-based, quota-based. This debate is continuing. As long as our feeling is that as a developer, we believe that we will have to go through these cycles of representing to the government, policy advocacy, and pressure from other side, international, everything will happen. As long as there, the government depends on the saying that the tariff has to be low. At the same time, and that we must import because we don't have capacity, as the local people will like to have the capacity. They will need to have protection. They would like to do that. And so that is there. And we, as of now, from the mobility of people in India as developers in the beginning, in the initial days, we had problem with qualified people. However, Saurav was mentioning, we have never faced a challenge in terms of qualified manpower. The people are qualified enough, but as we go for higher capacities and more volume, we might face a stress of qualified people in numbers. Not the people who are not qualified, but we may not find the right. And government has identified this as a requirement. They have started skilling centers for the solar installation. So we hope that will have a problem. Rather, what India is looking at is, if in the neighboring countries there are, probably people from India can go and do that. It's not the other way around. I think that's all from my side. I'll be happy to discuss anything else. Thank you.
You describe one situation in which in a strong domestic content requirement context, which at least as a transitional, in a transitional situation, you have clear inadaptation between the what you call a too granular production scheme with on the one hand, and obviously a project size that doesn't fit, where those two do not fit together, and that leads you know, not only to increased procurement costs, but also to obviously delays, project delays. And I think that's a very, it's a very good illustration of a possible result here. I think you clearly do emphasize the importance as domestic content as a critical issue. You give us a sense of where could be a way to deal, and I think I want also just use we have heard from you before as well, the you know, and where are the opening windows where we could look into, and you gave us an opening windows, Ambassador Fried, for calling for looking at differentiated energy markets as one way, and I think I hear from you as an opening window, you know, let's not forget that we made to refine the way we look at classification of goods, and this could help us in some instances. And I think your Solar Alliance may point, vision may point to some of those elements. And I think that's certainly very interesting things. You point out the 300 million of energy poor, and globally this is obviously 1.1 billion. I think it's I wanna build on the Kenya case that was made before. Simply, I had to. It's very important to see how local policy goes hand in hand with trade policy in this context. I think it's very important to see that if I talk to Kenya, my understanding is in India there's lots of good policies when it comes to the subsidy side, but when it comes to empowering rural entrepreneurship, I think we see the most dynamic today in countries such as Kenya. And I think what makes Kenya so successful is that on the one hand they combine the import you know, low tariff context, so enabling whatever they can to bring tariffs down, with at least on the rural side, a laissez-faire context where they say, actually, we start solving problems only once they are there. And in the meantime, this is currently 86% of the 1.1 billion are rural population. It's the area where we see no progress without new solutions. And so let's just let the solution be found by those entrepreneurs who can. And I think that's a very interesting combination of, you know, defining a space, so a third window, if the first window is the differentiated energy markets, the second window is perhaps the classification of goods, the third window could be this, you know, defining the no-lose spaces where nothing happens in current context, and the question, how do you open up there? But I want to move on. I want to move on to a very different perspective now, and Kunetsugin will provide one on behalf of Switzerland, and Switzerland obviously is a country that stands on the other side. On the one hand, it has already a relatively clean energy mix, but it wants to clean up further. How does it do it? But but clearly, it's a country that is that wants to promote its own innovation and find ways how it can deliver it to market. So, what is the perspective from Switzerland, Kunetsugin?
Well, thank you very much, and first of all, thanks to ICTSD and the World Energy Council for organizing this event. It's a very interesting discussion we have among different players, and it's always important to have this discussion. At the same time, the discussion up to now shows how complicated actually the issue is, and how diverse the angles are that we're approaching. And I try now to give you a bit of a perspective from a Swiss policymaker and how the situation looks in Switzerland with regard to the energy market and the clean and renewable energy solutions for the future. Some of you, or a lot of you, live in Geneva. You've probably heard that Switzerland is discussing an energy strategy 2050 at the moment, and it's now just discussed in the parliament. And this, I don't want to bother with all the details and the nitty gritty of it, but it shows how broad and wide the spectrum is, and how broad and wide the interested parties are in this discussion. And of course, also in Switzerland, all this discussion is framed by the Paris Climate Agreement, and the target to reduce climate emissions, but also to reduce other environmental impacts from energy production. Furthermore, we had the decision by the parliament to quit nuclear power production, and this also frames the policy we are making now in Switzerland for the future of the energy production and energy supply. Talking about climate change, of course, several before talked about the need to reduce the impact from energy production on climate change, but at the same time, actually, energy production suffers also from climate change. And it's also one aspect we have to look into. For example, in Switzerland, the water supply to produce hydro energy is changing, and this changes also energy production itself, and that's a challenge that where energy producers have to find solutions for. So this interaction is quite important as well. And furthermore, a challenge that presents to us in the moment is the change into more renewable energy production is not that easy, as we said, because we are also facing different energy supply, and how can you actually react to that different energy supply? We have different demand and supply changes, so how can you react on this peak supply and peak demand in the energy sectors? A third challenge that we face also is the energy price in Europe. We have especially the hydro producers in Switzerland, they face low energy prices, and this has actually an effect on investment. And it was very interesting to hear also from the business perspective that this plays that crucial role. And we have the same situation in Switzerland, but maybe from a different angle. And I think that's also an area where the policy has to react and where we have to find solutions. And now coming to the aspect of trade, and I think trade has actually quite some solutions at hand to face these challenges. And some have been mentioned before, and we heard in the 9-point plan of Canada, and I may want to touch upon some of these issues as well. And I think one important aspect is also the trade in energy itself or in electricity per se. I mean, if you trade electricity, for example, between countries, you can actually flatten out energy supply and demand, supply peaks and demand peaks of electricity. This may be one solution, but also it gives you the possibility to store electricity. For example, we heard that batteries is a way to store energy or especially electricity in the future, but we have also like the more old technology of pump and storage power plants in Switzerland. And I think trade in this regard can play an important role. And on the other hand, of course, we have trade in goods for clean energy production as one solution to that. And I think the important aspect here is to make clean energy more affordable and more accessible for everybody. And you can do that through different ways. And one way we heard before is DGA. That's something where I'm personally involved as well. And I'm really hopeful to find a solution, but I don't want to go into this discussion too much at this point. So we will see how this will lead. And just talking about DGA, I heard just the call for the HS classification. That's something, of course, that we face in the negotiations, and that's something that we try also to solve. And this definitely has to be is discussed in also in the national area. That's something that we try to find solutions. On the other hand, there are of course a lot of non-tariff barriers. We've heard it before. They are much more important than tariffs themselves. That's something that we hear continuously from business. The problem there is much more that they're much more difficult to deal with, especially when it comes to international negotiations or discussions at the WTO. So reducing tariffs for environmental goods and renewable energy products is one low-hanging fruit that we try to pick now, and certainly we're going to also to discuss non-tariff barriers and also services in the future. Talking about non-tariff barriers, I think we can approach that in a very large, from a very broad viewpoint, and I think what is important is also to see what makes the relative prices of renewable energy high, and therefore we also have to see for at energy prices for fossil fuels, and I think the discussion about fossil fuel subsidies has to be taken up and at this place, and to see how can we reduce the fossil fuel subsidies and therefore make also clean energy more competitive in this way. So I think from a policy perspective, the question about the pricing of energy and how to make energy, renewable energy, more competitive is a very important one. We have heard local content requirements as a very important part there as well. And I also heard the call the issue about border carbon adjustments from Canada, and that's also something that which is very controversial, but where we see a discussion from the politics in Switzerland as well. How can you actually make the competition more fair with regard to climate emission from the production? So this is a short insight from the Swiss.
Thank you very much. I think you make it very clear that NTBs are more difficult to deal with. We have heard the same, by the way, in the ambassadorial breakfast this morning. The same point was made there as well. And probably the question is, well, if you're really saying it's double as important in terms of its impact as the, and that doesn't mean the EGA should not be considered a priority, obviously first things first, but the question becomes things like local content, which seems so dominant in this discussion, you know, how can we make progress on this? I think you mentioned the subsidies context. It's important to highlight that, but I think we observe a number of countries who make great progress on this. Indonesia is an example. You can think of countries like the UAE with their diesel, etc. You can think of countries, even, you know, we have India here today, but I think one of the most fascinating stories in getting rid of subsidies is probably one of the biggest engines for fossil fuel subsidies is a misguided perception that this helps alleviate poverty. And I think India has probably had the most creative approach with LPG reform in just saying, well, 95% of that subsidy goes totally to the wrong place. Let's just give everybody a bank account. And that's revolutionary. Let's give everybody a bank account and make sure that those who really need the subsidy get a direct credit. In line with the, in line with what they would have otherwise received, and for the others, the subsidy is taken off, and that is, I think, the LPG subsidy reform context in India. There's great examples out there, and all I want to say, this is important an issue, but there's great dynamics in this issue. I think there is really progress. Many countries can make progress in that. But I want to go to Ingrid from ICTST for the last contribution. You have obviously a big picture. You have done your own studies, etc. You want to probably start helping bringing things together and putting in context with some of the studies that you have at ICTST.
Okay, thank you very much, Christoph, and thank you to all the speakers. Indeed, I don't know what I can add, really, because so much has been said. But we have been doing some work in ICTSD looking at the barriers and the drivers for value chains in the clean energy sector. So I think I'd like to share a few findings from those studies without going too much into detail. So, I mean, the reason for governments wanting to scale up clean energy is, of course, the climate imperative. But we also heard about providing the need to provide access to energy and to ensure energy security. And this has all been committed to in the Paris Agreement and in the Sustainable Development Goals. And the energy market and the clean energy market in particular is very policy driven and actually created by policy. So looking at the drivers first for clean energy and also for value chains in the clean energy sector, there is a range of fiscal and regulatory instruments that have been used in almost all countries trying to promote the clean energy sector. And they target consumers as well as producers. So looking at the regulatory side, renewable energy targets are very common. They have been, they exist in as many as 136 countries. And they are deemed to be necessary but not sufficient in themselves. Feed-in tariffs are also one of the more common instruments. They have been used by 103 countries and are also very important for stimulating the sector. Among fiscal incentives, tax reductions of different kinds are the most common. However, the effects on manufacturing are maybe less certain. Then we have public investments, loans and grants. They're also common, but also, again, with some mixed results. So just to sort of summarize the main findings on the drivers, what we find is that the most effective incentive for attracting manufacturing is a competitive domestic marketplace with a growing demand for power and minimal policy instability. And any incentives which are geared towards reducing prices or improving competition are likely to be the most successful. So then looking at some of the barriers, well, we've heard about many of them, but I think I would like to begin by reiterating what Ambassador Fried was saying, is that many of the barriers are not necessarily trade barriers, but we need to look at a much broader picture. So something that has come up quite frequently in our studies is the issue of access to finance, which was very well elaborated by Sarab as well. So that's really perceived as a main obstacle. And then since I mentioned that a main driver is policy, well, a main barrier is also policy. Unpredictable government policies is very difficult for the industry to deal with. So, for instance, very high subsidies is very attractive to begin with, but they're also risky because they risk being phased out very abruptly, and that's difficult for the industry to manage. Same goes for local content requirements. They can be attractive, but then they are also WTO incompatible, so you also face the risk that they will be reduced. So policy stability is really a key issue. Lack of policy coherence is also perceived as a barrier. So for instance, if you have a tariff reduction on the one hand, and then you have an anti-dumping tariff on the other hand, or you have a local content requirement. So these are all instruments that go in opposite directions. So there is a lack of coherence. There is the issue of policy silos, where energy policy is often not very well integrated with trade policy or with climate policy, and that's also something that contributes to this policy instability. Then looking more at the specific trade policy barriers that we have observed, well, anti-dumping duties, of course, is a very concrete obstacle for some agents who wants to export. The issue of standards is something which is growing in importance, and that also relates to what Sarah was saying before, that with this increased competition and costs going down, there is an incentive to compromise on quality, and that is being balanced by an increase in the growth of standards, and that's increasingly difficult to cope with, and it can constitute a trade barrier in the sense that often they are not harmonized. And actually in the session after lunch, we will hear more about standards, particularly in the solar sector. And then services, so finding the right skills and talents is one thing, but then also there is a more trade-relevant angle of that, and that's the actual barriers to the movement of service providers. And services is actually a very important part of the value chain in both wind and solar. So this is why, from ICTSD side, we keep saying that the EGA is really a very useful first step. But we need to go beyond that and also look at services. And then, yeah, one last thing that has come up quite frequently is also the capacity of the grid to deal with renewable energy and then access to the grid. So I'll not be very, very long, but a few words to say that some of these barriers can obviously be addressed domestically. But for some of the other measures, there is a need for international collaboration, like, for instance, on standards. Well, you need to harmonize internationally. Yes, I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Ingrid. I think very good overview, and again, emphasizing the importance of policy, not only stability, but also harmonization. I think you make that point very clear. You make also clear that there's like a step, one after the other. The EGA is probably a first step that, while more not easier in the current context, still must be a high priority. I think the fact that let's not lose sight of the services side, and obviously the NTBs obviously being critical after that. I think in terms of issues that stand out, and we have not much time for discussion, unfortunately, but I think I'd like to just put two things on the table, simply because they have been so prominent. On the one hand, I think the question of how can we, in a context where things are not moving as dynamically as one would wish for, perhaps, how can we open up small windows, or what are their windows? In the ambassadorial roundtable in the morning, the question of, how can we encourage bottom-up through, be it bilateral agreement, take those to regional agreement, how can we work things bottom-up? I think we have, again, heard the differentiated energy markets. We have heard, classification of goods, steps that countries can take, but also then the dynamics that lead to that, and Canada being an example who has to lead those dynamics, and want to hear a bit more about that. And the focus theme I suggest we are tackling is the local content theme. It's coming out in all contributions. I think local content is one that is has, on the one hand, legitimate calling for, but on the other hand, clear complexity when it leads to the learning curve delivery that we need. So, can I invite comments from the panelists, but also from the room, just on those two on those two sides of the issue? So, first, what are the current, what are openings when it comes to what do you see as potential opening forwards, but specifically also in the context of local content, what are good guidance models that you see? Can I invite perhaps for content? Perhaps if I may put you on the spot, Ambassador Fried, because I gave you some time to reflect about how Canada has managed to converge some of those views, and perhaps you have comments on the other things as well.
Well, we can have a little side conversation about who's the most decentralized, since Switzerland has wonderful experience in managing its cantons. And as we learned in the context of the Canada-Europe agreement, the EU, in dealing with Wallonia and others, has certain decentralization management challenges as well. But the lesson, and I think we've heard it in different ways from all of the panelists, is one moves policy through engagement and consultation of the stakeholder community. And stakeholders include those levels of government who have responsibility, and in many countries, whether they're federal or unitary or not, local governments and others have some responsibility for zoning, for medium-term economic development, for attracting investment, and so on. The industry, the citizenry, and organized or not, from NGOs. If you build a consensus by way of engagement, education, and understanding, then there's more buy-in to proceed with policies and, in light of Ingrid's comments, to maintain policies with the predictability that one needs for the 25-year investment to give the participants confidence that this is worth doing. The second lesson, I think, again implicit in what we've talked about, is anticipating the social, or can I call it the human capital, part of your infrastructure that you need, and that means investing in skills. That means understanding the relationship between not only building the plant, but having the legal and accounting and financial advice that says, well, here's how you actually manage the energy tariff going forward. So as to give the participants in the renewable energy industry the kind of return that's required. It means bringing in your financial advisors to say, and it's an interesting discussion, you may have observations, is it best as a sovereign asset? Is it a public-private partnership gives the private sector some return? Does the government have a role as a guarantor to lengthen period of return and so on? So that's at the national level. Internationally, I think, as with most initiatives, it's iterative and it starts small and socializes out. You begin with some like-minded, and you say, we share an interest, we share a goal, we share a vision. Let's talk about the various means and why we see it as being of benefit to many more than just us. And you talk it up. You don't go into a committee meeting informally and say, here's my proposal, adopt it for resolution at our next meeting. One builds out. Again, through dialogue, conversation, exchange of views, taking account of different perspectives. Local content in our context, frankly, is beside the point. Honestly, the rules are clear, as we found out yet again in certain recent dispute settlement cases involving both India and Canada in separate cases, and in other sectors has been a pretty clear prohibition. Developing countries or those who can benefit from special and differential treatment might make the wrong policy choice, but that's not going to change by way of further rulings. That's going to change by way of the kind of dialogue, education, and the word from the investors that says, look at the cost structure. Look at what you're doing. As a result. So bottom line sounds very trite in my perspective, but I think sincerely goes to answering the question, and that's engagement and consultation. So to come full circle in Canada, that's exactly what we did by putting Quebec and its hydro-based industry, supplying most of New York as well as its own citizens, at the same table as Alberta that has an interest in and the current government of Alberta a very serious interest in sustainability of that oil and gas anchored industry through this transitional period of 20 to 50 to 70 years, whatever it is, to a carbon-free economy, and saying, all right, what is the common interest? Because we all share that long-term goal together. It took several meetings at several levels, from technical right up to political, to bring people to say, okay, I see overall the national benefits. So it's engagement from the outset. I don't know when the European Commission first started talking to Wallonia, but I don't think it was at the beginning of our negotiations.